How's everybody doing? I hope you're having a good day. If you're new to the channel, my name's Sheldon Thomas, and this is the S&S Horseshoeing YouTube channel. Today we got kind of a special case, and if you watched my last video, you know that we're down in Arizona, where I'm usually up in Washington. We're down in Arizona visiting some family, doing some internships and stuff. So because of that, I get the opportunity to take care of these horses. So my sister-in-law ended up rescuing this horse. She got two horses for her kids to ride. What happened was there was a family in the community that, as her kids got older and got more involved in sports, they realized they weren't giving enough attention to their horses. And these two horses are retired rope horses. And as their kids grew, their kids were riding them and using them. And their kids got involved in sports and they realized they just weren't giving them the attention that they needed to. And they were kind of neglecting them. And so my sister-in-law was looking for a horse for her kids. And so they ended up adopting these two horses and are getting them taken care of back up into shape. Unfortunately, the horse, like you read in the title, the horse we're working on today has ringbone. And I'll go through with some pictures later on in the video and explain exactly what that is and how it affects their feet. As you can see, it's been a little while since they've gotten trimmed. And with ringbone, there is some shoeing stuff you can do. And you probably need to get a vet involved, get some x-rays to make sure that's exactly what's going on. But with a little bit of knowledge I got, it's pretty obvious that it's ringbone. And the biggest thing that's most obvious is no matter what's going on, we need to get their feet taken care of. Their feet are just too long. And so if we decide maybe here in the near future to get some x-rays to maybe try some different shoes on them. Unfortunately with ringbone, there's not a ton you can do in terms of shoeing. Basically the further up you get away from the foot, the less what you do to the foot can affect it, if that makes sense. So if there's something in the pastern, it's easier to affect that with shoeing than if it's in the fetlock or up in the knee, or you're almost not doing nothing up in the shoulder. If you have a problem up in the shoulder, what you do to the foot doesn't really matter. So just real quick, I wanted to apologize for all the shadows in this video. Normally I try to get that taken care of and try to get either in the sun or in the shade, but with this video we ended up getting up early in the morning before it got hot, and that just made it to where the shadows were real long and kind of put some bad shadows. But anyway, I apologize. Hope you can still see what I'm doing really well.
She wants to know what you're doing, right?
She wants to know what's happening.
She just wants to know what you're doing.
And that's not to say that a bad shoeing job doesn't affect the whole animal and that everything has to be in alignment and stuff. I mean, we all know if we put on a bad pair of shoes and do some work or something, our knees are going to hurt, our back's going to hurt. But that's not what I'm saying, is that it doesn't matter. I'm just saying beyond a good solid trim and or a shoe job, beyond that, you can't really help out a horse that has some arthritis up in his shoulder by how you do a shoeing job. You just need to do a good solid job. Anyway, enough with that tangent. Back to what we're doing here. So this foot I'm trimming right now is the one that has ringbone. And here's a picture of what ringbone is. There's two different types of ringbone. There's high and low ringbone, depending on which joint is affected. And you can see in this picture, if it's the lower joint, which is called the coffin joint, if it's in the higher joint or the pastern joint, then it's high ringbone. And this horse has high ringbone. You can just tell from where the inflammation and swelling is on the leg right above the foot. And actually, if they get lower ringbone, it's actually going to be inside the hoof capsule, which lower ringbone is a lot more painful because it's inside of the hard hoof capsule. And so when they get arthritis in there and the bone starts to expand, there's nowhere for it to go because it's encapsulated in the hoof capsule. So like I just mentioned, basically ringbone is what we call arthritis when it gets into the joints of the lower limb. Okay, so I talked about it. You could take this horse to the vet and get an x-ray. And like I said, we haven't done that yet, but if we were, this is what I could imagine the x-ray looking like. So to start off, the red arrow is pointing at the fetlock, the green one's pointing at the pastern joint, and the blue arrow is pointing at the coffin joint. And so like I said, the arthritis here that you're seeing is where the green arrow is pointing. You can see at the red arrow and blue arrow that there's a joint space. And at the green arrow, there's no joint space, and you can see there's extra bone being laid down there. It's a little bit bigger, and that is what makes up the arthritis that we call high ringbone, which this horse has. In its left front, you can see now I'm working on the right front, which you could tell she's struggling. It does hurt her, but obviously we got to get this foot taken care of. most of the time I say in my videos that this doesn't hurt or that doesn't hurt, but this actually is hurting her, because what I'm asking her to do is I'm asking her to put all of her weight onto her bad foot or bad leg. But she's leaning on me quite a bit, and you can tell I'm starting to breathe pretty hard because I'm basically holding up this half of her body because she's not wanting to put it on that other foot, so I'm having to hold it up, and she's fighting me quite a bit, which is understandable because it doesn't feel good. But we got to get this foot taken care of, or this foot's gonna end up in worse shape than the other foot, and this one will be her problem. So anyway, we just got to kind of fight through it and get it done. And also, I'm trying to just go as fast as I can so she doesn't have to stand on that foot for very long. It's not going to be as pretty of a job, but it's just trying to get the length off of there and get a good functional trim so she can feel better on this foot. Okay, so let's talk about what causes ringbone or arthritis in the pastern joint. It's pretty similar to what causes arthritis in all other mammals, ourselves included. Basically, like I mentioned, these horses are 20 years old. And so just with age, we all get arthritis in some places with age. So just the wear and tear on our bodies that life puts on us. Also, if they have bad conformation or something that's causing there to be a lot of concussion in that joint, that can also cause ringbone, like a straight up and down pastern, where instead of the fetlock taking the shock absorption, it's just coming down and beating on that joint space and ends up making that cartilage mad, ends up turning into arthritis. So also an external injury, I mean, something gets caught on the fetlock or something like that, that can cause arthritis. In terms of what can be done about it with a vet, so they can actually go in and fuse this joint. There's only two joints in a horse's leg. One's in the hind limb in the hock. It's one of the small joints in the hock. And also this one, it can actually be fused. Because it's such a low motion joint, it doesn't move a whole lot. The other joints on the coffin joint and the fetlock joint move a little extra when you fuse them and make up the difference. And it can actually, horses can go back to being sound. If they're a young horse, they could potentially go back to full work. So with this horse, we'll talk to the vet, see what they want to do. Okay guys, I think I've regurgitated all the information I know about ringbone to you guys. If there's something I didn't cover or a question you have, just make sure and go down in the comments, ask away, and we'll try to get it answered for you. Remember, if you do ask a question, make sure and let us know where you're from. Kind of makes it fun to read through the comments. Okay, as we move back here to the back feet, you can see they're not quite as overgrown as the front feet, just the way she carries herself. She must trim up a little bit. You can see what I'm cutting out right there with the nippers. That's what I call false sole. It's just a ton of retained false sole there. Just gets built up. I could go at it with my knife, but remember, I'm down here in Arizona in the middle of summer, and it's pretty dry, and those feet are hard. And so just, it's easier for me. It's a trick if you're a farrier. Just, I carry a smaller pair of nippers. You could use a pair of half round nippers and just get in there, get that sole and get it out. Just make sure not to cut too deep, because then you'll have blood everywhere. But anyway, just get in there, get that retained sole out of there, and then work it after that with your knife. Kind of something I have a lot of people comment about, and I don't know where it comes from, but a lot of people talk, or like they ask me why I'm hitting the frog, because they think the frog is sensitive. And as you can see right there, there's nothing more, the frog's not any more sensitive than the rest of the foot. So when you're cleaning out your horse's feet, go ahead and get in there with your hoof pick. It actually needs to be cleaned out the best right there, because that's where the thrush will build up, is in there with the frog. And you can see I take and shape it up with my knife, and if the horse could feel that, it would let me know. So the frog's not any more sensitive than any other part of the foot. I'm not sure where that myth comes from, but it's definitely made out of a different material, but it's not more sensitive. So, and if your horse's frog is sensitive, it probably means you got some thrush problems or something like that. So make sure and address that if you do find that it is sensitive, but it should not be for a normal, good, healthy horse. Something you'll notice is she actually does really good when I'm trimming these hinds. It's just that right front that really gives her problems with the ring bone, just because she has to put all of her weight on her bad foot. But when I'm doing these hinds, she does actually pretty well. One thing I am doing to help her out, which might go unnoticed, is my hoof cradle has two settings. There's a real tall setting and a short setting. And on little horses, or on just older horses, their just range of motion doesn't work as good as it used to. And so I'll use that lower setting. You can see when I was moving from one hind foot to the other, it's on a lower setting. And you'll notice in other videos I use the higher setting. It makes it a little harder on me when I'm using that lower setting, but it makes the horses a lot more comfortable and stuff. So it's kind of a tip if you have horses that are kind of being a pain. Sometimes if you just lower it down and make it more comfortable for them, then they'll make it a lot easier on you. So something I forgot to mention is how you trim a horse with ringbone to help it out. And right here in a second, I'm going to show you a side profile of the front foot that has ringbone. So basically what you do is you put a pretty mean rocker on the front of that foot, which what that does is helps there be more motion between the ground and the foot as the horse steps, and less motion in the joint, because what makes arthritis hurt is when that joint moves. And so if you can make that joint move less and make the motion be between the foot and the ground and not in the joint space, then the horse is going to be more comfortable. So you can see that from the side profile. Okay guys, that's all we got for this horse. Hope you guys enjoyed the video. Make sure and like, subscribe, and we'll catch you next time.